Welcome to this week's episode of Inside the SPHL. It's been a really busy day. As most of you know, I record on Mondays, even though it drops on Wednesdays. And I had a pretty big day. I got to go watch the Bulls beat the Havoc. And the guy that I have on the show is also somebody that was there. He had a little bit of a closer seat than I did in the whole thing. And he's from Lewisport, Newfoundland. And he's played parts of season since the 18-19 season in the FPHL and the SPHL. He spent a little bit of time playing hockey in New Zealand, so that's pretty cool. We're definitely going to talk about that. So without further ado, I'm going to introduce you guys to my guest. He is from the Birmingham Bulls. This is David Nippard. David, what's up, man?
Hey, James, how's it going?
Oh, not too bad, man. I mean, you had a big win today, so you got to be feeling pretty good. It was a pretty good weekend all in all for you guys.
Yeah, no, it was a pretty crazy win, especially at home against the first place team. I mean, it's pretty special. We got a good group here. You know, we're kind of, I guess, hitting our stride, so to speak. But it's definitely a good feeling beating old Huntsville. That's for sure.
Yeah, that's for sure. You played there too, so that's got to be a little better too, right? Beating your old team.
Yeah, you know, it's kind of good to share the ice with some old buddies and stuff like that, but. The old saying, like, no friends on the ice, right? But afterwards, I got to meet up with a couple of the guys and share some stories. So it was nice. It was really good.
Yeah, good deal. Good deal. So then the weekend, I guess I'm going to start this off different than every other one that I usually do where I ask an elementary question. But you guys' weekend started out really rough, and I think I take some of the blame for that because last week on the podcast, I said Macon sucks at scoring, and I was eating a bowl of crow for breakfast that next morning. So you guys turned it around though. But
yeah, it's funny. I saw one of your tweets and you said something like, I take it back. Macon is capable of scoring or something along
those
lines.
Yeah, something along those lines.
Yeah, yeah. And actually, you know, I felt quite bad, you know, with our new associate head coach, Kevin Kerr, going back to his old barn. It was kind of tough to swallow that one. But, you know, coming back, we beat Pensy. And then obviously tonight, we beat Huntsville, and our goalie has just been absolutely red hot the past two games. So it helps when we have good old Stewie between the pipes, you know?
Yeah. He's playing awesome. I know at one point there in the second period, you guys were getting outshot 30-14, and I'm just sitting here. I was like, holy crap, Stewart's carrying this team right now. But not to say, I mean, Rose's goal there, that really helped a lot at the end of the second period.
Yeah, no, that was incredibly – perfect timing. I mean, Rosie's my roommate. You know, we talk every day, and it's kind of cool. You see a rookie coming in as a first year. I think he's got 11 goals this year, scoring, you know, with a couple seconds left. And him and Mike Davis kind of went like tic-tac-toe type thing, and he went forehand, backhand, and, you know, got the place, the roof almost came off the place. So it's kind of nice to see Rosie scoring some goals like that.
Yeah, for sure. For sure. Especially after, you know, that scary moment against Knoxville about a month and a half ago. I mean, that was rough. It's nice to see him back out there. I bet you guys feel the same way.
Absolutely. Yeah, just to touch base on that. That was, you know, you see some pretty crazy things happen in hockey. You know, he took a pretty crazy hit. Marvin Powell, one of our D-men, actually playing against Huntsville in Huntsville, took the skate to the neck or the face, and you know, those are the things you never want to see, but it's good to have Rose back in the lineup and doing what he does best. So it's good.
Yeah, for sure. For sure. Let's talk about you a little bit. You held an award at one point back in New Zealand, but this year you're on track to get it right now. You're leading the league in penalty minutes, whether you want to or not. I mean, that's something people are noticing. I guess I don't really know how to ask this question, but it almost seems like some of your game is just getting all up in everybody's faces. And then every once in a while, do you feel maybe it's because you're David Nippard and that's why you're getting some of these calls? Is they're like, oh, we got to watch that on the ice. I mean, do you ever feel that way?
That's an interesting question. I mean, you try to have a good relationship with referees, so to speak. And oftentimes then it doesn't really work out.
No.
I find the more you talk to the refs, the more you're on the radar. But that being said, you know, the longer you're in the league, you know, they even call me by nickname now. So it's interesting. The style of hockey I play, it's kind of, you know, crash and bang in your face a little bit. And sometimes it works in my favor, other times not. But
yeah,
there's been some calls this year where it's Nippard. Yeah, we're going to, you know, going to toss him with maybe two, sometimes maybe a five for phantom spearing, but hey, it is what it is.
Yeah, that one, that was at the end of a game a while back. Yeah, that was rough. So I remember that
Yeah,
one all too well.
that one still stings.
Yeah. You didn't get suspended for that one, did you?
No, and I mean, I don't want to say too much with respect to refereeing or anything like that, but I think they might have felt a little bit bad because of the outcome of the game, so they didn't slap a suspension on me. So
Yeah. Hey.
that was Knoxville. Yeah, Knoxville came back and won in overtime, and then unfortunately, I get the same call against Pensacola, I believe. And yeah, it's hockey. I
Yeah.
have no hatred towards the refs. It is what it is. We're all
Yeah.
we all make mistakes, right?
Now there's enough hatred towards the refs from the fans in every barn in the league. I don't I, those poor guys, everybody hates them. They forget those guys aren't NHL refs too, so
Well, even the NHL refs get shit on sometimes, so
Oh yeah, absolutely. Absolutely.
yeah.
It's just part of the game too. I think the fans are the ones that have to hate it. But you said talking to the refs, you're more on their radar. I mean, you're talking to everybody on the ice. Every time I see you, you're talking to somebody out there. So
Yeah, it's almost like a little game within the game. I mean, you got buddies and stuff, you kind of chirp here and there, but a lot of times you're trying to get under guy's skin, or it's a good time out there, and it's a good thing we're not mic'd up, that's for sure.
Yeah, no, I was actually, it's funny you say that. I was talking to somebody today. I was like, they really need to mic up Nippard. I know for years it was Kolzicki everybody wanted mic'd up, and I was like, I don't know. I think Nippard would be pretty good too. So
Yeah, no, it's a good idea, maybe not to do so.
No, probably not. There's a
Yeah.
reason nobody's doing it right now.
Yeah,
So
I want to stay in the league for a little bit longer, you know what I mean?
yeah, I hear you. I hear you. So let's jump back a little bit here. So you're from Newfoundland, and we kind of touched on it before we started talking, recording. And there's not a lot of guys, playing hockey out of that province in Canada. Why is that? I mean, you're from there. You have all the answers, right?
I'd like to think I have the answers. I mean, Newfoundland is a smaller province. If you look back, there's been a large number of NHLers kind of play in the league. It's now on the rise, but with respect to the SPHL, myself, Scott Trask, who was the captain in Huntsville, Morrissey, Shane Morrissey played, and so not very many guys from Newfoundland have played in the SP. But it's beginning to be on the map. Some guys from have played like World Juniors. The Growlers are there. So
Yeah.
before the Growlers was, it was the Fog Devils. It was they had the American League, the St. John's Leafs. They had the Ice Caps. So hockey's very, very big there. But with respect to resources, and it's not too plentiful. I mean, every town has a rink, but it's minor hockey, or the exposure is not quite there. With that said, actually, the hat I'm wearing right now, it's Danny Cleary's hockey school. Danny Cleary is a well-known name in Newfoundland. He's still involved with the Detroit Red Wings. And this year, I had the pleasure of working at his hockey school. So they held a showcase, and they had some coaches from the Maritimes come down, and some university coaches. So it is growing in Newfoundland, but with that said, it still needs more exposure. But they're definitely working on it.
Yeah, for sure. So growing up there, who do people from Newfoundland root for in the NHL? I mean, who's your team? Is it the Maple
Well,
Leafs?
so basically, growing up, I think when you're born, it's like, okay, you're a Leaf fan, or you're a Habs fan, or you're a Bruins fan. And I was fortunate enough. Well, I mean, not fortunate enough, but I'm a Leaf fan. They're a bit of a wagon this year. I mean, say what you will, they might make playoffs and then be an absolute bust. But yeah, it's either Leafs, Habs, or Bruins. And I mean, if you ever run into a hockey fan from Newfoundland, they're pretty passionate. So I try to stay. If anybody asks if I'm a Leaf fan, I just say I'm a hockey fan. I don't want to, that's about it for me.
Well, and you don't want to hear first round exit jokes over and over again, right?
Oh
So
my God, no, it gets old. You know what yeah. I mean? Maybe I need to find a new team or something. I don't know.
You got to stick with it, man. The second you do, that's when they're going to win the Stanley Cup. So,
well, yeah, I can be a pretender. You know what I mean?
Yeah, that's right. That's right. So I don't know. I kind of feel your pain being an Avalanche fan because, you know, I'm from Colorado originally, and second round exit after second round exit, that's the story of them in the last, you know, 20
so
years.
Alex Newhook, he's a newfie. There you
okay.
go.
Okay. Yeah,
so,
yeah, yeah.
You know, you got a couple guys. His sister Abby, she's also an unbelievable hockey player. So yeah, there you go. That's a yeah. Newfoundland connection right there. So
just like that, yeah. And I should know that, man. I'm supposed to be an Avs fan, but
so, no, hey, so, it's all good.
But so did you play juniors in Newfoundland, or did you have
to? So with respect to juniors in Newfoundland, they have a junior B league based out of St. John's, and I think the big reason for that is the population in Newfoundland is so low, right? Yeah. It would be the same as like Prince Edward Island having a junior league. Like they can't really have the numbers to do so. So with that, no, you kind of have to leave the island. A lot of people who go places, you know, with hockey, they do have to leave the island to do anything. But there is a junior B league in St. John's. I think they have like six or seven teams or whatever. And usually what happens is a lot of people who go to the Memorial University of Newfoundland in St. John's, they don't have a university team that competes in U sport, okay. unfortunately. So what they do, I think they go to university in St. John's and then they just play in the junior league there. So it's they do have hockey. And that being said, there used to be a senior league that was huge. They used to fly guys in, pay them like some pretty good coin, and they used to compete for the Herder, and then the winner of the Herder would go play for the Allen Cup. And okay. I don't know if anybody here in the South or in the States really know what the Allen Cup is, but it's one of the oldest trophies in hockey. And if anybody is interested, just Google the Allen Cup. It's really, really interesting. Very, very cool trophy. It's like three feet high.
Wow.
I had the pleasure of, you know, seeing it up front. One of my buddies had won it, and it's really cool. So if anybody listening, check out the Allen Cup, check out senior hockey in Newfoundland. It's an absolute treat.
Yeah, that sounds really cool. So
yeah,
so you let me scroll down on my page here where I'm stealing notes from.
After you
decided you were going to go pro, you ended up in New Zealand. And up until about 30 minutes ago, I didn't even know New Zealand. I knew Australia had a league. I did not know New Zealand did. So how in the hell did you find out that there was hockey in New Zealand, man?
Yeah, it's funny. After college, I had an opportunity to go play in France, and I took it, thinking it was just going to be my last year and, you know, kind of enjoy myself. And I lived in a ski resort, which was sweet. So we'd ski every day and play hockey and stuff. After the season, I'm traveling and I'm in Prague, and I wake up from a night out in Prague, and I get a message on my phone from somebody who played in New Zealand. And I had known about like the Australian league and whatnot. So a guy, it was a weird connection, a buddy of a buddy kind of reached out and was like, "Hey, would you be interested?" And I was like, "Yeah, 100%. Like, what's the deal? Like, when do I have to be there?" He's like, "Oh, next week." I'm like, I'm in Prague right now. Like, so I jump on my phone type thing. I get back to Canada because the whole visa thing. Get back to Canada, kind of tag up, pack my stuff. And I don't know anything about this league. I'm just like, I'm going to New Zealand. I'm a big traveler. I love traveling and checking out new stuff. Pack my little duffel bag, my hockey bag, and hit the road, and ended up going to New Zealand and playing. So the experience was incredible. The hospitality in New Zealand is much like the South, very welcoming, very, very homely. When I got there, I just felt like, you know, everybody is so friendly. Hockey is very foreign to them. So they love when imports come in and play. And the interesting thing is, we actually flew to all of our games.
Oh, wow.
So, yeah. So like, it was really cool to jump on a plane and check it out. New Zealand split into North and South. So we would fly to all of our games and, you know, running into fellow Canadians and stuff like that. It was pretty wild. So,
Wow, that's awesome. How big were the planes you guys were flying around in?
Like normal sized planes. Like
Really?
it was legit. It was very, very legit. Auckland obviously was where I played, one of the bigger cities, and it was incredible. If I didn't play hockey, I was surfing, or it's pretty wild. They love the Canadians because they think, Canada hockey,
Yeah.
they go crazy. But no, I can't stress how much fun it is. I know a former Bull, Casey Kolzicki, he used to be my roommate here actually. He played in the Australian League
Yeah.
and he loved it as well. The Australian League's a little bit bigger, a little bit more popular, I'll say. But no, the New Zealand League is definitely a blast. And the only accolade I have from there is leading the league in pins. So,
Yeah,
surprise,
hey.
surprise.
Hey, you took something away with you. What was it? It was 96 penalty minutes in. It says 18 games played is what I got, so
And I think I got 30 my last game.
that's all. Oh yeah. Hey, tell me, I gotta know about this last game then.
We're playing for the Burgle, the Burgle Cup. It's called the Burgle Cup. It's a really cool thing. Basically what happened, we're playing in Queenstown, which is a beautiful spot, much like Banff, Canada. For those of you who don't know what Banff is, Google it. It's unbelievable. So we're playing in the south, beautiful spot, and we're playing for the cup, whatever. And we're losing, and we kind of know we're gonna lose. And when you're losing the championship, there's one of two things you can do: you either swallow it and let it go, and or you can, battle to the end. I think there was like 2.5 minutes left, and I probably it might have been a late check. It might not have been a late check. Well, I threw a body check, which involved the gloves going everywhere and a little bit of a line brawl type thing. And it down there, anything to do with fighting or whatever, they just slap you with 10, 10, 10, 10. So
Wow.
yeah, my last game in New Zealand, if I ever decide to go back, I think I got like a 4-game suspie or something like that. So
You're gonna have to sit it out for a bit.
we'll see.
Is that how long the seasons are too? Is only 18 games?
Yeah, because it's basically the off season type thing, right?
Yeah.
I think another player who's played, JM Piotrowski, I think you had him on a couple weeks ago.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think he played as well. But it's honestly, it's a great way to stay on the ice and just kind of stay in shape and get to see a part of the world. I mean, for me to purchase a ticket and fly from Newfoundland, I'd have to maybe cut off my arm type thing. It's
Yeah.
so expensive. But I was very fortunate to get there before this whole pandemic thing happened, and I had the greatest experience. The team, they treat you like gold, so it was amazing.
That's awesome. How many imports are you allowed on teams, do you know?
You know what? We had, I think it's five or six. I think we had four Canadians. One guy was from Calgary. Yeah, a good buddy of mine. He's from Calgary, and it's just so strange because people get down there, and it's much the same as what I've noticed here in Birmingham. People get down there and they don't want to leave,
Yeah.
and the Canadians get down there, they find a female and they get their citizenship, and then they just don't leave. And then much the same as Birmingham, or like a couple teams here in the SP, guys love their city, love where they play, and they want to find a way to stick around and call it home. So
Yeah.
very, very interesting.
That's
And if
awesome.
I, yeah if I could ever recommend someone getting down there, get there, because New Zealand is incredible.
Yeah, that sounds great. Tell me a little bit about your off the ice time. You got any good stories you can share, your time out there in New Zealand?
New Zealand, yeah, I
Yeah.
mean, living in Auckland is pretty cool. The downtown life is crazy. Like it's pretty bumping, so to speak. But I had the opportunity, the family that I lived with, they had a beach house, and I would literally go surfing and enjoy the weather. They thought I was crazy because being from Canada, it's their winter when I go down.
Yeah.
So I would, I'll be swimming and doing all these things, and people are like, "What are you doing?" No, this is amazing. Like this is great. But
Yeah.
no, like it's just incredible that just to go down and check it out. The Hob or The Lord of the Rings was filmed there, so that's like a
Yeah.
huge, huge thing that people want to check out. The food is incredible, and one of the cool things I got to experience, I was walking downtown in Auckland, and obviously rugby is their national sport. So I'm walking downtown and there's a huge Adidas store, and I go inside and they're doing a meet and greet with the All Blacks, which is their national team. And I got a really cool picture. I should send it to you. I'm playing foosball with these guys. One guy's like 6'7", 300 pounds. And yeah, these guys are absolute mutants. So I got to meet these guys and hang out with them for a bit. Like it was incredible. So I was starstruck type thing. Like, okay, these guys are the real deal. So
yeah, the guys that could break you in half, you feel like they're just so big.
They make Cody Deion look like a kid.
Yeah, that's like, ridiculous, man.
Yeah, like, yeah, and Cody Deion's not a kid.
No, he's a big dude out there.
That's
ridiculous, man. That's a lot of people don't realize that everybody. I mean, hockey's definitely a hard hitting, rough sport, but I mean, those guys that play rugby, they're fucking insane, man.
It's barbaric. It's absolutely barbaric. I think, like, if I were to rate sports, it would be rugby, lacrosse, hockey, and then football with respect to like how crazy it is. And football's up there. Like, you get some. Every play is a car crash type thing, right?
Oh, yeah.
But the thing is with hockey, you can't run out of bounds. And, you know, I'll always say hockey's a little tougher. But I'm telling you, rugby is crazy.
Yeah, it's just ridiculous. I try to follow it and try to – like, I was remember watching the Summer Olympics last year, and I was watching rugby because the game fascinates me. But I'm just sitting here, and I was like, what the hell are they doing?
Literally killing each other.
Yeah. I mean, it's a brutal sport, man. But that's cool. That's awesome. You get to meet some of those guys. So that's cool. So so when you played in France before you went to New Zealand then?
Yeah. I was lucky. My assistant coach at the Southern Alberta Institute of Technology, located in Calgary, Alberta, had played in France, and the season concluded. It was my fourth year. I was kind of deciding, you know, if I wanted to start a big boy job or a career or whatnot. And he kind of put the bug in my ear, like, you know, would you be interested in playing in Europe or whatever? I kind of thought about it. And I was like, you know, I may as well. My body feels good. I can go, you know, see Europe or whatever. So he put me in contact with the team. And before you know it, like, they offered me a spot to come play. And I jumped on it. And it was crazy. The team, Morzine, they used to be in what's called the Magnus League. And obviously they got bumped down. And usually what happens is if you win the league, you get bumped up to the next level. If you win that, you get bumped up, right? And relegated and whatnot.
Yeah.
It'd be kind of cool if North America adopted that. You know, like for instance, Pensacola won the league last year and they got promoted to the East Coast League.
Yeah, that'd be kind of cool.
Yeah, you know what I mean? Like, it'd be kind of neat. I don't know if people would enjoy that or let that fly, but it would definitely be very interesting.
Yeah, I mean, that's how soccer is all over there in Europe too. I mean, it's a system that works. I mean, if you suck, you're stuck down at the very bottom. I mean, if you're a good team, I mean, like, you look at Huntsville, I don't know. I think some years they could probably hold their own in the coast.
I mean, Huntsville speaks for themselves. You know, you got they go back-to-back, so that's very, very hard to do. They're a very special team. They got a great thing going for them. So,
yeah, we're not here to talk about them though. They lost today. So how different was France playing in France compared to like the way that you had played hockey growing up in Canada? Was it
very
less contact?
Yeah, I actually remember my first game. It was myself and my teammate from Canada, Pat Martins. We went over, and Pat actually absolutely laid a guy out first game. Like, it was like third shift into the game, laid this kid out. He comes back to the bench, and the coach literally looks at me and goes, "We don't do that here." And I had to almost pick my mouth. I was like, "What in the heck is, like, this isn't hockey?" Yeah. A little bit different. And I think, like, the higher the league over there, it's a little bit more physical, but, you know, you get guys who want to go over and play at the end of their careers because it's a little bit easier on the body, so to speak. Yeah. Not as many games, but yeah, a little different style of play. Actually, one of our new players, Hobbs, he just came back from Sweden, and the first thing he said was like, I need to get back to North American League or North American style of play because it is way too soft over there. So, you know, everyone's got their style of game, and I'm glad Hobbs is over here because the kid absolutely loves it. You know what I mean?
Yeah. And he got in a little scrum right off the bat in this game today and held his own. So he knows the way to earn his way into Bulls fans' hearts because that's what Bulls fans love.
his first game we're in Macon, and cutting one of their tough guys, arguably one of the tougher guys in the league. He got the upper hand in cutting, and hope cutting's listening to this because I'll be the first one to admit he took cutting. So that's good on his part.
Yeah, that's awesome. That's always cool. I know that's always kind of been the style the Bulls play. You know, we're gonna beat you up, and we're gonna beat you on the ice. That's the goal. And so he seems like he's gonna fit in just fine. So.
Oh, big time! It yeah. I mean, I think it's unfortunate, but I think we're leading the league in penalty minutes as well.
Yeah, I think so.
Yeah. But
there for a while, it was a little closer than that. But I can pull that up right now.
So yeah.
But yeah, it's I don't know. It was a rough start. Kind of actually that you brought me into a question off of that is the season started out. Yeah, you guys are 575 in minutes. Quad City's got 527. They're gonna catch you. You guys haven't gotten a lot of penalties lately.
We're on a tight leash, I think. So gotta
behave. Right. That's right. But so tell me a little bit about the start. I mean, the season it definitely didn't start out the way you guys wanted it to, and it seems like here in about the past, well, really the month of January, things have kind of turned around pretty good for the better. So
just a bit about the beginning. You know, a lot of fresh faces coming in. With this year especially, you don't really know who's going to be coming in, who's played in the league, who has experience and whatnot. We had a pretty young squad, fresh squad, and guys were chomping at the bit wanting to play. We couldn't find a way to win, which was a little bit deflating. I remember at the beginning, you know, we get a lead, and if somebody scored, you know, it was a little bit like, oh no, like, you know, you're kind of battling just to kind of stay afloat. And I don't know. I just think like it just kind of clicked. You know, Coach Simchuk has been, I said it the other night, he's been with us through thick and thin, and he wears his heart on his sleeve, and he absolutely loves it. And I feel like we're really playing for him now. And having, you know, Coach Kevin Kerr come in and help our team, like, you can see the beginning of the season Bulls to now, it's completely different team. And it's the locker room vibes are better. Guys are just buying into systems, and it's just things are starting to gel and starting to come around. And it's been a lot of fun to see this transformation. And it's been fun. We definitely got something special going on. Obviously we're competing for a playoff spot, and I think that's really lit a fire under a lot of guys to kind of, you know, step it up and really, really want to win, not just for the Bulls, but like for coach Simchuk and Coach Kerr. And like, you know, you just got a big group of guys that you just want to play for. And of course, Mike Davis has been here for numerous years, and those are the type of, yeah, you know what I mean? Like that guy in particular, you just want to win hockey games for him. Like I remember there was a couple times we were on a losing skid, and I sit across from Mike, and I'd look over, and I'm like, oh my God, you do everything but cry for the guy. You know what I mean?
But
he's another guy, wears his heart on his sleeve, and he's a hell of a captain, and those are the guys you want to win for.
Absolutely, absolutely. I mean, I noticed him like earlier in the season, you guys, it just seemed like everything was like, I don't know, maybe the word is you guys weren't loose. You guys were kind of playing tight, and here in, I don't know, even dating back to, you know, the end of last year, like December, it just seemed like you guys were starting to do more. You were coming into the zone cleaner, and I mean, I know everybody might think they know you all for penalty minutes, but I mean, you got some stick skills, and you got a shot, and people are starting to see more of that from basically the whole team. I mean, it really seems like you guys have loosened up a lot as the season's come along.
Yeah, absolutely. I think at the beginning, when you got guys coming in who are kind of new to the league, it's almost as if the old saying, like, you gripping your stick too tight, maybe a little bit timid to like make a mistake, or, you know, they were making hopeful plays, we'll say. And now, like, as the year's gone on, guys are actually getting comfortable and they understand the level of play and they're adapting. So with that being said, the guys have a little bit more poise with the puck, more confidence to make plays, and bounces start to go our way. And when that starts to happen, guys get more comfortable and you get on a little bit of a roll. And then it's almost like Huntsville. There was no way they were losing. They would be down in games, but they would still win. We're kind of getting that vibe where it's like, you know what? We've been in so many games. And it's just been unfortunate. Things used to go wrong at the perfect time for us. You know what I mean?
And exactly.
It's just for some reason, something would happen. And at the exact perfect time, it would go wrong. It went wrong. But we had a saying at the beginning when things were starting to turn around. It's like, hey, we need to turn the ship around. And we're definitely turning that thing in the right direction. So. It's for the better, and it's been a lot of fun. And today was kind of very, very special to get that W.
Yeah, for sure. What was the locker room like today after, you know, when you guys, I know you guys had to hurry up and take your pads off and go right back out and skate with the fans, but I mean, you guys got a little bit of time to enjoy it what was that like for you guys?
Yeah. Hey, especially for, you know, for Hayden, he's had a bit of an interesting up and down thing going on when he was in the coast and came back. With Macon, obviously it was a tough game. There's no doubt about it. But then for him to get back-to-back shutouts, when he walked into the room, I'm surprised the fans didn't hear us, because we were very excited for him. You know, he's a hell of a goalie, and same with Austin Lotz. You know, Lotz, he's up in Norfolk, but those are the guys that you want to win for as well. And the locker room was vibing. That's for sure.
Yeah, that's for sure. I think Stewart, I mean, that's, I think, his third shutout of the season. I mean, he's playing really good, and you can't look at the stats. So there's a lot of guys on this team. You can't really look at the stats. You got to really follow the team, really, and you see that, you know, the numbers are deceiving, because, I mean, Stewart's one of the, in my opinion, he's one of the better goaltenders in the whole league. But
And I would agree 100%. He literally is. Stewie's one of my better buddies on the team, and I talk to him daily, and I'm always saying to him, like, hey, I love having you here, but you shouldn't be here. You know what I mean? But I don't want him to go anywhere. And just back to what you're saying about, like, you know, the points and the way, you know, people get caught up in statistics all the time, and it's just the way it goes. But, you know, you look at the stats, you look at even, like, our goalie stats, for example, and it's unfortunate, because people are quick to judge. But you, like you said, you follow the games, you watch the games. These guys are making some ridiculous saves.
I don't remember if it was him or Lotz, but there was like 60, almost 60 shots against, and it was a one goal loss. And I'm just sitting here and I was like, how are you gonna take that away from him, man?
you don't. And actually, Lotz, he was in net when we won in a shootout earlier this year, and, you know, some of their best shooters were shooting against him, and he was just like robbing these guys of, you know, it was unbelievable. But Birmingham always has great goalies.
There's no doubt about it,
you know? And I think that makes it very easy to get goalies to come here, because they know, like, you know, they want to play. We've been doing very, very well lately as well in the shots column. Beginning of the season, we were getting doubled in shots every game. Our defense have really stepped it up. There's been games where we're doubling teams in shots. We've definitely come a long way.
Yeah. I mean, today, really, with the exception of that second period, you guys outshot Huntsville, but the second period kind of got away from you guys. But that was three penalties in the first 11 minutes too. So that'll hurt. How do you guys, or you personally, I guess I can say, you can't speak for the whole team, but how do you come out of that after taking a couple of bad penalties team wise? It doesn't have to be you in particular, but and you say you get scored against. How do you get out of that? How do you get out of that mind and just move on? I mean, that's got to be tough.
Yeah, it is tough, and I think that was our problem at the beginning. when we did get scored on, whether it's 5-on-5 or power play. It, like I said, it was very deflating. then you have to battle twice as hard to kind of get out of that hole. But lately, our special teams, like our penalty kill, we just literally go out on the ice, and we have the mindset of like, we're not going to get scored on. And, yeah, you know, and that makes things a little bit more easier. But when you do get scored on, you just got to kick it into another gear, and you got to realize like we're capable of doing that as well. I think we put up 8 against, was it Fayetteville or Knoxville?
Fayetteville,
at home?
Yeah.
Fayetteville,
yeah, guys, yeah. Yeah, you guys came back on Fayetteville and put up 8 on them.
Yeah, so, you know, we're capable of doing it. And I think there were a few games we kind of – there were a few games. I think we went like 4 games. We only scored 1 goal, I think. It was crazy. But,
yeah,
you know, guys are scoring. And for – you know, I always resort back to Huntsville because they were successful at the end of the year. But it seemed like everything that they threw on net at the end of the year went in. And, yeah, you know, the tables are kind of turning now, and we're getting what's called puck luck. And, you know, the old saying, you create your own puck luck. And I think we're working hard enough that things are actually starting to go our way, which is it's good to see finally, you know.
Yeah, absolutely. So tell me about what you bring to the team. I mean, like in my opinion, what you bring to the team, and this is kind of probably a dumb question, but you bring like that attitude is kind of the way I want to put it. I mean, I'm not taking away from what you can do in the game, but like your presence out there, it's almost like everybody knows you're out there when you come out there, because you're a very talkative player on the ice. I don't think I ever see you not talking when you're out there. If the in between whistles, I mean, somebody's going to hear something that you got to say. I mean, is that something that you've always done, or is that kind of something you've adapted as time has moved on?
Well, it's interesting. I think coming into a new team, you kind of have to find your role, and you know, I know coming in, you know, we got Rosie, we got Mikey, we got a couple guys who are here to score goals. And then you got a couple guys who are here to, you know, to not get scored on. And then for me, it's kind of like, you know, an older guy, you got to find out what works for you type thing. And, you know, you talk about the statistics, statistically speaking, you know, I'm probably not up there with respect to those, but you know, if I'm not getting scored on, I feel as if like I'm doing my job, so to speak. I like to play a little bit of a running gun and, you know, lay the body and kind of get in your face type thing. And sometimes it works, other times it works against you, you know, and you get caught in a rut sometimes where, you know, you're trying to be physical and get in guys' faces, and then you find yourself in the box. But yeah, it's something I've always done. Actually, it's, I don't know if it's maybe because I'm from an East Coaster and we like to put our work boots on.
Yeah.
But yeah, I've always kind of put my work boots on and my hard hat and just grabbed my lunch pail and carried on. So if you know, if you could find a way to stick around and it works and it helps your team, then, you know, you stick with it. If it was the inverse where it was hurting my team, okay, now I got to figure out a different style of play here. But no, Coach Simchuk put me in the faceoff dot this year. And, you know, if I'm winning faceoffs and not getting scored on and trying to create some offense and some energy, I think it's okay.
Yeah, definitely. I hear you there. So what, you got any good on ice stories that you can share from your years? I mean, you played in the FPHL, which is, you know, everything there seems to be a good story whenever I hear them, because that league's just crazy sometimes.
You know what? If I could request you to get somebody on here,
yeah,
it would be Joe Pace.
Yeah.
If I could just request you to like throw Joe Pace on here for like 10 or 15, well, it'll probably turn into like 2 hours. He is full of stories. Okay. And I remember the first time I met Joe, I had a very interesting, you know, if it wasn't for Joe, I probably wouldn't be in the SP. He gave me a shot in Port Huron. I remember I took the bus from Winston-Salem all the way to Port Huron. It was a 24-hour bus ride.
Wow.
Yeah. And Joe Pace picked me up in his truck and brought me to the rink. And it was the McMorran Arena. And I walked in. And at that time, McMorran had like the old rustic seats. And you could tell there's history. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So I walk into this barn and I'm like, where in the world am I? Like, and I've been, I'm from Newfoundland, and he kind of took me under his wing, and the stories I probably shouldn't tell you like on the pod, but like, next time we're at the rink, I got a couple stories I can definitely tell you. Absolutely. But no, if you could get that guy on, he's got some very interesting stories and some good ones, that's for sure.
Yeah, I might have to look into getting him because that does sound good.
Yeah, that's big time. He has an encyclopedia of on his elite prospects. The guy's actually been everywhere, and he knows everybody. You know what I mean?
Yeah. So that's awesome. Yeah, he sounds like a good guy. Maybe he can get me to 5 listeners from 4 too if I bring him on. So
he'll share that thing on Facebook everywhere. You know what I mean? Yeah. So him and I actually got in a little bit of a tilt there in Pensacola the other night. So I think I kind of owed that one to him.
Yeah. he's kind of, that's all right. But shit, man, that's pretty much all I got. I don't want to take up too much of your time. I know you just played a bunch of hockey this last weekend and you had a long day today. I mean, I don't know, I guess in a hockey game and being able to come and jump on a podcast a couple hours later, that's kind of weird, playing afternoon hockey.
You know what? It was interesting. The matinee game was kind of cool. We got into the rink and the sun was still kind of up. So it's been an interesting week. For me, it was 4 games in 5 days. So the old body at my age, I got a pretty good skin routine. Guys think I'm a little bit younger than what I am.
Yeah. You got the product.
You got to keep people guessing, right? If I could grow a beard like yours, I'd probably rock it. But
they're a pain in the ass. And my wife won't let me shave it anymore. I get sick of it because I'm like, I got to brush it. I don't even comb my hair. I throw a hat on. So
that will look good on a hockey helmet, I tell you that.
But yeah, definitely. If I could only stop on skates, that's always been my trouble. I grew up doing roller hockey. That's what I played growing up a lot of. We didn't have the Avalanche showed up in Colorado when I was, what was I? I was 11 years old. So I was already past my prime of being able to be an NHL star. So, but I played a lot of roller, and then I tried to ice skate the first time, and yeah, I just used the boards to stop, and I never stopped playing that way.
Hey, sometimes I use those to stop too. So
yeah, it's convenient that they put them there.
Yeah. You should have joined us for the skate with the Bulls today. I could have maybe taught you a couple things.
Yeah, I should have, but I didn't want to make a fool of myself. I seen some of those 8-year-olds out there skating like the wind, and I'm like, yep, not for me.
I'll tell you, this actually, I mentioned to Carson. So we jump on the ice, and like nothing against like people who organize this stuff, like, hey, it is what it is. In Canada, if you were to jump on the ice without a helmet, and you didn't know how to skate, that would be like, that's a lawsuit waiting to happen. Like, you know what I mean? And today I'm watching and I'm like hoping and praying and crossing my fingers that there's no, you don't need the ambulance to come out on the ice because people were just falling down. I'm like, oh my goodness. No helmets on, no gear on. I guess that's how you learn not to fall, right? Don't fall because it hurts.
Yeah, exactly. I was always afraid of breaking my ankles. That was my thing, is like, if I stop too hard, my ankles are going to break.
It's going to bend over, right? Yeah,
that's right. Yeah. I mean, be pointing a different direction than it should be. But it's like kind of like, who was that? Kirby Doc, when Kyle McCarr pretty much broke his ankles with leather.
Goodness. You ever watch the movie Goon?
Yeah.
Yeah. Kind of like that. He's wearing figure skates to his first tryout.
That's awesome. Awesome. That's one of the greatest movies, I think. People don't give that one enough credit, I don't think. They like to stick to Slapshot, but Goon is our modern era Slapshot.
Slapshot's up there, I'll tell you that.
Oh, absolutely. But
it's Goon, man. That we might have to watch that tonight, actually. Rosie's sitting over on the couch watching the East Coast All-Star Games, probably taking notes, so.
Yeah.
Jeez, who knows? Yeah.
Sitting there, he's like, I should have been here.
Yeah. Yeah. Putting on a clinic out there, hey?
Yeah. I'm surprised he hasn't been called up yet.
Yeah. We don't need him to go anywhere.
No, I agree. I think it'd be bad for the team. He's out there just doing all kinds of crazy shit, and people are just like, what just happened?
Yeah. So, no, he's, I think he's comfortable where he is, and I think he needs to stay here.
Yeah, that's good. So I know I ruined a bunch of Bulls fans' lives right before the weekend started. Whenever I found out you were getting called up, they thought you were gone forever. And I probably should have told them that I was pretty sure it was a one game call up because Jacksonville is playing in Atlanta, and that's kind of how it goes every once in a while. But I didn't want to say that and be wrong, so I was like, "Eh, screw it. I'm just gonna let them know." And I got messages, "How come you always give me bad news? Blah blah blah." And I'm like, man, I'm just telling you guys so you know, because you're all going to be asking. So, I mean, somebody's got to break the news to
you. Oh, my goodness. I did see that. And, yeah, that was an experience in itself. Nick Lucco actually is the head coach of Jacksonville, and it was that was crazy. So, like I said, there was a lot of hockey for me in 5 days, a lot of travel. I ended up driving to Macon. I drove to Macon in my car. Drove back to Atlanta, did morning skate, played that night, drove back to Birmingham that night, got on the bus. We went to Pensacola, came back, and then we played tonight. So it's been a blast.
Yeah, that's for sure. That's for sure. You should probably be sleeping right now, taking a nap. That's what you should be doing. Most guys get to take naps on the bus rides down, but you were driving yourself all over.
So. No, I love it. You know what I mean? I wouldn't want it any other way. So,
I hear you, man.
Yeah.
But all right, man. Well, I'm not, like I said, I'm not gonna take up any more of your time. I really appreciate you coming on, and I wish you and the rest of the team good luck the rest of the season, and maybe we can catch up and do this again later on down the road, and maybe it'll come true that whenever I bring guys on the podcast, they start scoring goals. So I'm gonna need you to remember me if you score some. So
hey, you know what? If you're ever at the rink and I score in a home game, I'm gonna be looking for you.
Yeah, that's right. That's right. I try to act cool. I sit right below Eli Gold because he's real press. I'm fake press.
No,
that's the way I look at it.
You gotta make your own badge. You know what I mean?
Yeah, that's right. Yeah. That's right. So, but
hey, James, thanks for having me on here. It's been a blast.
Yeah, absolutely, man. And we'll catch up again later on down the road. And like I said, good luck the rest of the year, man.
Thank you very much. I'll see you at the rink.
All right. Well, there you have it, David Nippard. I hope you guys like that. As always, I enjoyed it. I enjoy talking to these guys all the time. So it's always a blast. And like I said, I hope you guys enjoyed it, whether you like him or not. I mean, these guys are all when you hear them talk, whether you're a fan of the team or not, you start to realize that they're human just like you and me. And I know a lot of you guys didn't really like Cody Deion because he doesn't play for your team. And I'm hoping that after that interview, you guys kind of see, hey, this guy is a human. He's just like me. And I'd love to have him on my team. So who knows? Who knows? Maybe not. Maybe you guys are going to hate everybody and I can't do anything about it. And I don't care. Like, I'm just going to keep trying to bring guys on and entertain you guys for a good 30 minutes, 45 minutes. And then I'm going to bore the hell out of you for another 30 minutes talking about things around the league. So like I said, you know, today's been a pretty busy day for me, a game. And I was there at the Birmingham Huntsville game, and it was a pretty exciting game. We'll get into that. I'm going to do what I usually do, and I'm just going to kind of walk through game by game. I'm not going to dig too terribly in depth because I don't know that you guys really care to hear as much as I have to say. And half the time, the stuff I say is ridiculous, and it doesn't even make sense to me. So we're gonna let it fly. That's what we're gonna do. So let's this past week of hockey, it actually started last Thursday and it ended today, even though this is a new week. Today is Monday. I guess you guys will be listening on Wednesday or later, or hell, 3 months down the road, who knows? But anyways, this weekend of hockey started on Thursday, ended on a Monday with Birmingham and Huntsville, and it started with Birmingham and Macon. And if a lot of you guys remember last week, I was talking about how I never say teams suck, and I'm always trying to, you know, act like trying to be positive. And I do. I try to be positive about all these teams. I don't think these guys are all professionals, and a lot of these games are, you know, one bounce goes the other way. And some of these teams, you know, that are down on the bottom, Birmingham, Macon, Vermilion County, I mean, one bounce goes the other way, or it's a whole different story, and you're looking at the standings different. So it's tough to say the teams suck as a whole. And Macon, I don't know if anybody listened to that podcast, but from the team, but good God, did they prove me wrong. They beat the brakes off the Bulls. 6-1 at home last Thursday night. And, I mean, it was just goal after goal after goal. And, you know, Colton Fletcher started the scoring out. And you kind of got a feeling watching the game, yeah, the Bulls are going to win this one because, you know, Macon doesn't score a lot of goals. Well, that was incorrect. Macon went on to score a lot. Lambrecht scored a hat trick. Caleb Cameron got a goal, who also got his 100th career point over the weekend. That's a huge accomplishment at any level of hockey. So congratulations to friend of the show, Caleb Cameron, on that one. That's a pretty big deal. And, I mean, it just – Hansen scored a couple of goals, and Macon just steamrolled the Bulls at home. And it it had to feel good for the boys. It had to really feel good for Macon. They have struggled to score a lot of goals, and they've struggled to score more goals, I guess you'd say. Maybe not a lot of goals, because they've had some high-scoring games. They just were on the wrong side of it. They definitely weren't that night. They handled it, and they got the W. And that was how the week of hockey started, with a very, very one-sided game that really wasn't fun to watch for anybody, and except for Macon fans, of course, because, I mean, what fan doesn't like to watch their team beat the crap out of another team? So we had that, and then we'll move on to Friday. So Roanoke and Fayetteville, I think they only play each other this year. I think they're just – every game this year is going to be against those two. We're never going to see them play anybody else. And Roanoke's been getting the upper hand of that lately. They came out with a 3-goal second period in that game against Fayetteville and ended up winning that one 4-1. And they continued winning against Fayetteville. I don't remember how many in a row that was against Fayetteville, but they handled business. And then let's talk again about Macon. They played another game on Friday night, and they played Knoxville. Knoxville, mind you, second in the standings, very, very good team. They're always in games, and Macon almost beat them. That game went to overtime, and that game also had Caleb Cameron scoring 2 goals. So the podcast works. I mean, people score goals after they come on it. How many times do I got to tell you guys that? I mean, Piotrowski started scoring a lot of goals. I mean, I don't know. Hey, players out there, if you're listening, which I don't know why you would, but if you are, just hit me up if you want to come on the podcast. If you're looking to score some goals, hit me up. So that's all I'm going to say. No, that's dumb. I hate when people say that. No, I don't, because I'm saying it. Anyways, Knoxville won that one 6-5. And, it was a very, very exciting game. Very exciting game. At Knoxville was 3-1 in coming out of the first period, and then Macon just kind of fought their way back into it, and it was just a good game. And Bulls fans, plug your ears, because I'm about to say who scored the overtime winner, and I know you guys have some hurt feelings over this player being in Knoxville. Casey Kolzicki scored the OT winner, and it was just a pretty goal. It was a pretty goal, and Kolzicki is fitting in very well in Knoxville, just like Colton Fletcher is fitting in very well in Birmingham. If you're going to look at probably one of the better trades of the year, I'm going to say that was a good trade, because it's worked out very well for both teams. And I mean, that's what you're looking for when you're a coach. You're looking out there to make trades. That's what you want to do. You want a good player, and you can't give, you know, a player that's barely hanging on the roster a way to get a good player. So you got to give up a good player, and you hope that it doesn't hurt your team. And as a fan of the game, it's always nice to see both players go on and do well. And so there was that. So we'll talk about Quad City and Evansville next. So Quad City and Evansville, Quad City handled business. Evansville still kind of struggling here as of late, and they got beat 5-2. They were really never in this game. They kind of were, they kind of weren't, but they were struggling through this one. And we know Quad City's a wagon. They're out there just taking care of business all over the ice. And so they ended up winning that one 5-2 on Friday night. And then here's how Huntsville's weekend started out, as the next game we're going to talk about. Pensacola, who, you know, they've played Huntsville pretty much as often as Roanoke and Fayetteville play. And so you're just sitting here wondering, are they ever going to beat them? Well, yes. The answer to that is yes. Pensacola got them 3-2. They came out in the first period, and they scored 8 seconds in. So scoring 8 seconds in, you're always going to feel good about yourself. And the game was in Pensacola, so you got the fans in it. And you know, and I mean, Huntsville's number one in the league, so the fans know that. And so the fans are extra excited whenever you score 8 seconds into a game. And they walked out of that first period with a 2-1 lead, and we all know don't count Huntsville out whenever if you're going to leave them in it, there's always a chance they're going to come back. And there was nothing going on in the second period on the scoreboard. And then in the third period, both teams added another goal. But Pensacola's goal that they added was the deciding one. And Huntsville, granted, they've got you heard Nippard say, I mean, Neudecker's playing in the ECHL All-Star game. So they've got guys up in the coast right now that are missing, and they're making impacts in the ECHL with their teams right now. So yeah, they are missing a few players. They're just like every other team in the league. They've taken some hits, but I'm not going to say that's why they're losing. I mean, that's kind of ignorant to say. I mean, this is professional sports. So they still got their core there. They still got Jacob Barber. They still got Piacentini. They still got all these other guys. And granted, Kaiser's sitting out for his long suspension. But I can guarantee you not a single one of those players are going to say, oh, well, we lost to Pensacola because, you know, call-ups and we're missing players and blah, blah, blah. No, hockey players aren't going to make excuses because Huntsville's winning without those guys. So, no, that was just Pensacola outplayed them. They won that game. And good for Pensacola. It was nice to see him finally get a win over the Havoc. And whether, I mean, if you're a Havoc fan, you probably don't like to see it, obviously. But I think the rest of the fans in the league are kind of happy that the Havoc are not invincible anymore. And they're starting to show signs I don't even know the word I'm looking for. Who cares? We're going to move on. Next game, Vermilion County and Peoria. They played Friday night. That's the last game of Friday night. And Vermilion County just got chopped up into little pieces. 8-2, they lost that one. 3-1 in the first period, 6-2 by the end of the second period. And then Peoria added on two more late. Let me look here. There's got to be at least 17 hat tricks in this game. Hageman got a hat trick. Laidley got a hat trick. So you got two guys scoring three goals. It was just poor Vermilion County. I'm sorry, guys. That sucked for you. But Peoria fans, Peoria team, props to you. That's how you beat a team down. And Peoria is really coming on. The longer the season moves, the more we see Peoria just improving. And you remember Peoria was the first team to hand Vermilion County a win, and a lot of people were kind of joking on them over all that. But I don't think you could joke on them over that anymore. I mean, yeah, you can. I mean, they were the first team to lose the Bobcats. So, I mean, it's forever etched in the history books. But we all knew somebody was going to lose to the Bobcats, and a few teams have now. So, hell, the Bulls have. So yeah. Anyways, let's talk about Saturday. Let's go back to Macon, where Knoxville and Macon faced off again. Another overtime game. Mind you, Macon, the team I said that doesn't score a lot of goals, they have been scoring like crazy this whole week because they're like, oh, James, you're a jackass. So we're going to show you that we can score goals and win games. They won this one 4-3 in overtime. And it was a good game. That was probably the best series of the weekend. Probably so. Because those two teams, and it was unexpected. And I'm going to say it again. I didn't expect Macon to do this. I know Macon has the ability. I've seen them play. I know they got good goaltending and they got all this, and I've just never seen them put a whole weekend together like this. And yeah, they lost one, but they came out with points every single game, and that's what's important right there. So they came out with what, 5 points on the weekend out of a possible six. Very good play, very good play. And not taking away anything from Knoxville. I mean, Waxon Ingback got two goals in that game, and I feel like he scores two goals in every game. So, I mean, Knoxville is a force to be reckoned with, and it just seems like every game you see them in, it's going to be an exciting game. And that's enough on that one. Let's talk about everybody's favorite matchup, Roanoke and Fayetteville. Who do you think won this one? Yeah, you're right. It was Roanoke. They won this one 3-2. So they scored a goal, period. That's the best I got. I didn't really watch the game. I'm not going to lie to you guys. I'm looking right now on the SPHL website at that game, and I see 1-1-1 on the bottom row where the Rail Yard Dogs are. And Roanoke is – they're making moves in the standings. Let's put it that way. I think they've won 4 or 5 straight against Fayetteville. I had these numbers down. Written down somewhere. I was going to come in here like a true professional broadcaster, and I was going to be like, so Roanoke won their 6th straight or something against them. And once again, I fail my audience, and I am sorry for that. It'll probably happen again. So we'll move on. Next one, Huntsville and Evansville. So this one was, a snooze fest. That's the best way to put this one. So nobody scored until Nukovic scored 10:42 into the third period. I did catch some of the highlights on this game. And, I mean, Huntsville came out with a 1-0 lead over Evansville, but that was just it's boring hockey. Nobody likes to watch 1-0 games. What is this? Back in the early 2000s, whenever everybody was getting shutouts and Patrick Waugh and Marty Brodeur both had like 60 shutouts a season. No, that's not what we're here for. We like goals. That's why they made pads smaller and blah, blah, blah. Now, some of you might like a defensive game. I know goalies like a defensive game. But yeah, so we'll move on. And not to say that that game wasn't exciting offensively. If we look at the shots on goal, which I just looked at as I glanced down, you know, it was 38-28 in shots on goal. So there was it was a goaltending clinic, really, is what was going on there. And in the end, the Habit got it. And because we know that's what the Habit can do. If you let them hang around long enough, they're going to find a way to win. And that's what they did there. So after that, next one up, the Birmingham Bulls and the Pensacola Ice Flyers. Remember, the Bulls got beat 6-1 by the Macon Mayhem. Macon, who was below them in the standings, and some idiot podcaster said they can't score enough goals to win games. Yeah, that team. That's who beat the Bulls. So now the Bulls are playing Pensacola. That team, you know, that team that just beat Huntsville has got to have a big chip on their shoulder, feeling good about things the night before they finally beat the Havoc. You know that those guys were excited. I mean, it's got to be a good feeling, especially when you play the same team so many times. It's got to just feel good whenever you beat them. And I don't know, maybe it was a little bit of a hangover from that, but Pensacola did not win this game against the Bulls. Pensacola did not score in this game against the Bulls. This was shutout number 1 of 2 for the weekend by Hayden Stewart of the Bulls. And yeah, the Bulls, I mean, we were talking, we referenced Carson Rose when in the Nippard interview, and I think I've talked about him a few times here on the podcast. He's a rookie in the league, and he's got some awesome stick handling skills. He's got some great moves. He can break people's ankles out there. He added another goal in this one. And it was just an all around good game for the Bulls. Pensacola outshot him 32-23. But Hayden Stewart stopped all 32. The Bulls went 1 for 4, 1 for 4. Yeah. 1 for 4. They were oaring 1 for 4 on the power play. Pensacola went 0 for 4. Which, might I add, the Bulls' penalty kill is getting better. That's another thing. And I'm sorry, I have a lot of decent statistics from the Bulls. It's almost like that's the team that I cover. I should be covering the whole league. But you know how hard it is to watch every single team and know everything about every single team? It's pretty hard. I know a lot of guys on Facebook think they know everything about every single team. And I am more than willing to bring any of you on this podcast, and we can talk about every single team. If you know more, I'm all right with it. But and that's not a blow to anybody. There probably is people out there on Facebook and these groups and stuff that live and die by the SPHL, which I try to, but it's hard to watch a lot of these games when they're going on at the exact same time. It's very difficult. I mean, I only have so many TVs in my house. But yeah, enough with that rant. Anyways, Bulls win that one. So big bounce back game for the Bulls. And not a very good showing after taking down the Havoc for Pensacola. But it is what it is. Pensacola's kind of been up and down this year. They've most of their down has been when they played Huntsville, and most of their up's been when they played Birmingham. And they just they couldn't close out the weekend on a high note. That's all there is to that. Next one, Peoria and Vermilion County. You remember that 8 goals I just talked about? Well, they didn't score 8 this time. Vermilion County played a little better in this one, but they still weren't able to win. They lost this one 3-1. Laley got another goal. Laley's probably, by the time this podcast comes out, you're going to already know who the player of the week is, but there's a really good chance that it's going to be him. That's my early prediction that you guys can all say I went in and edited later to make myself look cool when it comes right, which, hell, maybe I did. You'll never know. Because my editing skills are amazing. No, they're not. I'm sure you guys can tell when I cut things out, especially on the video. But anyways, Vermilion County lost another one. Peoria won another one. That one went down 3-1. And that was it for Saturday night. So this was a very long weekend of hockey. There was a game on Sunday. And guess who played? Peoria and Quad City. Those two teams, they play each other a lot too. It feels like Peoria, Quad City, and Vermilion County are always playing each other, and throw Evansville in the mix. And those four teams are just, it's the North Division. That's what we're calling it, the North Division. There's more to it if you're really going to cut it in half. You should probably throw Roanoke in there, maybe Fayetteville. But those three teams, four teams, they seem to play each other a lot. Blah, blah, blah. Guess what? Peoria scored a lot of freaking goals in this game. Peoria scored like 45 goals this weekend. That's not the real number, but hell, it might be close. What was it, 8? And then they added a few more. They got 7. So I don't do math. They don't. Nobody pays me to do math. I failed math in high school. I took pre-algebra 3 years in a row. I am a horrible math student. And so if you ever see me up here doing this with my fingers, it's because I'm doing math. I'm trying to add. So just leave me alone. But I'm not going to do that anyway. So anyway, 7-4, Peoria, putting on a goal-scoring clinic this weekend. And Hageman got 2 goals. Neville got 2 goals. So, hell, Hageman might even get player of the week again. He was player of the month in December. It just seems like everybody on Peoria is getting player of something. So who knows? But they handled business. Bennett got a pair of goals for Quad City. And Quad City was actually winning this game coming out of the first period. They were up 2-1, and then everything was all tied up at the end of the second. I don't know what happened on the ice at that point. All I know is Peoria scored 4 goals in the third period, and Quad City couldn't match it, and they only scored 1. And sorry, guys, Quad City lost. Not sorry to the Peoria fans, because that's what they wanted. But that was it for that game. And then today's game, the game that I could probably spend a good 30 minutes talking about, but you're not all Bulls fans and you're not all Havoc fans, so I'm going to try to keep it brief. But it was the Bulls and the Havoc. It was an annual Martin Luther King Jr. Day. Martin Luther King Jr. Day game. That was a mouthful. But they do it every year. It's always Huntsville and Birmingham. It's always been in Birmingham. And it's a pretty fun game. 1 o'clock puck drop on a Monday. You know, a lot of kids are out of school because it's a holiday. A lot of people are out of school or out of work because of the holiday. If you work for the state anyways, government employees. But there's actually a pretty good turnout, too, for it. But after the game, everybody can go out there and skate on the ice with the Bulls, as David Nippard kind of referenced to earlier. And so it's always a fun game. And every time I've been to it up until this year, it's been a game where Huntsville just basically destroys the Bulls. And this was also Jacob Barber's first time back in Pelham playing on the ice against the Bulls since signing with the Havoc. And you could tell there was a few people I was talking to around the rink beforehand that everybody was just that was what they were thinking of. That's what they were looking at. They were wondering, and I was kind of wondering. I was like, is this going to be one of those scenarios like is he going to get booed every time? Rob Blake back in the day got booed every time he touched the ice when he was when the Avalanche played in L.A. I was wondering if it was going to be something like that. It never really ended up being anything like that. It was a little heckling before the game during warmups, but when is that not a thing? But no, so it was Barber's first time back there in on the at the Pelham Civic Center, and so that was a little storyline there as well. And the Bulls were coming off of a shutout, and Huntsville's kind of struggled this weekend. Obviously, they lost to Pensacola, and then they only beat Evansville by a goal. So it wasn't one of their best weekends. So coming into it, it was set up to be a pretty cool game, in my opinion, a pretty good game. And when they came out, I mean, the Bulls came out flying, and it was ridiculous. Like, you just felt like the Bulls were going to do something, but nothing really happened. Nothing really happened in that first period. I mean, it just didn't. It just didn't. Second period comes around, and the Bulls spent a lot of time in the box. That's one of their favorite places to be, is the penalty box. And they spent a lot of time there, and Huntsville just started throwing freaking pucks on net at Hayden Stewart, and Stewart stood the task. And I mean, I'm not going to say the defense hung him out to dry. I know a lot of that, you know, that was, 6 minutes of power play time, and there was a 5-on-3 thrown in there. And the power play, or the penalty kill unit, did good for the Bulls. Power play unit for Huntsville, it's not that they couldn't get it going, it's just the Bulls were just playing a little bit better, and the shots that were getting off, they were good, clean. Stewart could see the shot coming, and they were right in his body, and it wasn't nothing really super fancy getting in there. And then about 5 seconds left to go in the second period, and at this point you're kind of thinking, yeah, Huntsville's going to take this one, you know, going 0-0 into the third. These are the kind of games you don't let Huntsville hang around in. You should have put them away. You should have found a way to score earlier. Should have, would have, could have, blah, 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 blah. Carson Rose scored with 5 seconds to go in the second period. Momentum shift heading into the third. And they were, like I said, the Bulls were being outshot heading into the third period, 30-14. So that's going to put things into perspective for you there, and show you just how well Hayden Stewart really was playing in that game. And then later on in the third period, the Danny Licio, or Licio, I learned the way to say his name right today, and I already forgot. Anyways, he scored a goal for the Bulls, and the Bulls put this one away, and it was a good win for the Bulls. And you could tell by the conversation I had with David Nippard that the feeling in that locker room is things are changing and getting better. And if that's the case, then like I said all along, the Bulls got guys that can score goals. They got a lot of guys that can score goals. It's just a matter of scoring the goals, I guess. And as dumb as that sounds, I don't know, some of you may understand that, some of you may just turn the podcast off and never listen to it again after I said that. But it's something that if the Bulls can keep building on this confidence, and that's good. And for all you people that say that it's Coach Kerr that's doing all this, I do want you to know that unfortunately Coach Kerr, he's not with a team right now because, you know, that COVID shit that's going around. So he wasn't even there today. So you can't give him all the credit. Yes, he's making changes. He is the much needed breath of fresh air that this team needed. But give everybody else that's been with the team a little bit of credit here. That's all I got to say. But enough of that. Like I told you, I could probably spend 30 minutes talking about that game because it's so fresh in my mind. I was just there a couple hours ago. But that's really it for the games on the weekend. Let's take a real quick run down the standings and look and see how things look after this weekend. So Huntsville by the way, I am declaring this the official halfway point of the season. Not every team's played to the halfway point, but a lot of teams have. So I am declaring this the halfway point of the season. Whether the league or any of you decide it, this is whenever I'm declaring it halfway through. So Huntsville sitting up top with 50 points, big 50. They 24-5-1-1. Had a rough weekend, but don't count them out. And they're only sitting 3 points ahead in Knoxville. It's kind of been, you know, they were close. Quad City had a chance to tie up for first at one point, and so Knoxville's getting there. Huntsville has another weekend like this, and Knoxville will be number one if they have another weekend where they score more points than their opponent. Yeah, I just said that. I just said that. So anyways, next up on the list, Quad City, who's kind of stumbling a little bit, but not really. You know, they like I said, they lost their last game against Peoria, but they're still 17-5-2. They're still well up in there in the top, and they're a team people need to worry about. So Peoria, remember they've been like in that three-way, four-way tie for fourth place forever. Well, they finally own fourth place solely with 36 points, 1 point over the Marksman after a hell of a weekend. They're on a three-game winning streak, which I should also add that Knoxville is on a 10-game point streak right now. So I feel like I should have added that in earlier when I was talking about them. But, yeah, they have not they've gotten points in their last 10 games. So Knoxville's doing really good. Back to Peoria. So Peoria's playing really good hockey. They're 8-2 in their last 10. And like I said, they're sitting in fourth by themselves. Remember back whenever they're hanging out at the bottom and I was telling everybody and we're not going to count them out? And you guys were probably like, yeah, you're an idiot. Peoria sucks. Oh, they're finally done. They're not going to be regular season champs, blah, blah, blah. Well, I mean, I don't know if they're going to be regular season champs, but they are doing what I said they were going to do. They're moving up the standings. Moving on to number five, Fayetteville. Rough weekend against Roanoke. You'd think Roanoke would be in front of them by now, but I remember Roanoke had kind of a rough start. So Fayetteville's still sitting 1 point ahead of Roanoke in the standings. They got 35 points. They have lost their last two. They're 6-3-1 their last 10. Next up is Roanoke, 34 points. They're on a three-game winning streak. They, in their last 10, are 8-1-0-1. So they've gotten, what is that, 9 games out of their last 10 they've gotten points in? See, I can't even do math when it's right in front of my face. Why do I even try? Anyways. Next up, seventh in the league, Pensacola. They had an up-and-down weekend, and they're sitting on there with 32 points, still within striking distance of fourth place, which, hell, I mean, everybody's in striking distance of third place, really, at this point. I mean, there's a 7-point difference between second and third, but then after that, it's 8 points taking you all the way down to seventh. So there you go. I just did math really quick. I win. Didn't even use my fingers. They were down there. I was counting under out of the camera view. Anyways, moving on. Evansville, last and final playoff spot if the playoffs were to start halfway through the season with 26 points. They are 0-3 in there as their current streak. Not in a good place. 2-8 in their last 10. They just kind of lost what they had going for them at the beginning of the season. I look for them to get it back, though. I mean, the team was rolling there at the beginning of the year, and I mean, you don't lose that completely. They just they might be in kind of what we talked about whenever I was talking to Nippard. Maybe they're gripping the stick just a tad bit too tight. Who knows? But that's it for your playoff teams if the playoffs were to start today. And then we're gonna jump into ninth, where it seems like the Birmingham Bulls have been all season long. They have 6 wins now, though, and they were actually at risk. If they would have lost these games this weekend, Pensacola and Huntsville, they were looking at maybe dropping down to 10th. But since they were able to get those 2 shutouts, those 2 wins, they got 16 points. They are on a 2-game winning streak, which, fact check me on this, I'm probably wrong, but I'm probably right. This is the first time Birmingham's won 2 games in a row dating back to the 2020 COVID canceled season. I don't even think they won 2 games in a row last season, let alone this year, which we know they didn't. But so again, me with my all kinds of knowledge about Birmingham, you guys are already tuning out because you're going to think this is a Bulls podcast. I'm sorry. I'll do better. But anyways, the Bulls are 3-7 in their last 10, 16 points. They are sitting above the Mayhem, who got 12 points. The Mayhem are 5-21-1, and they're 2-0-1. And that's their current. They're on a 3-game point streak, 3-6-1 in their last 10. Things are just things are starting to work. Megan's another team. They're a lot like the Bulls with how they're starting to feel things. They started out with this really young core. They didn't have a coach to start the season, or though they didn't have their coach they thought they were going to start the season with, which you all know, Coach Kevin Kerr, who's now the associate head coach in Birmingham. But anyway, so rough way to start a season, very rough way. But they're definitely finding ways to score more goals than their opponent. And I am not saying they suck at scoring goals this week, unless, of course, you're a Mayhem fan and you want me to say that so they score a bunch more goals, in which, here you go. Macon sucks. They can't score enough goals to win games. But it's not going to work because they don't mean it. But I said it anyways. So last place in the standings, the Vermilion County Bobcats. 5-game losing streak right now. Just can't get things together. Still kind of trying to learn things. Plus they've had, it just seems like their entire roster is getting called up. And if they're not getting called up, they're getting traded. Like, there are so many. Look on the transaction page. The Vermilion County Bobcats are the king of transactions. They are trading everybody. They are, if they're not trading them, they're going to the ECHL. I mean, there's just, every day it seems like Vermilion County's trading one or two players a week. And so I know they're trying to make the team better. That's the goal. They're trying to build something, especially with all these call-ups. But that is tough on a team to just start with all these new faces in practice every week. And there's really not any chemistry outside of, you know, maybe the top line. And so maybe once Nick Niedert gets his team in place, the guys he wants, everybody he needs, and maybe some of these guys stop getting called up. I hope not, because I love whenever guys get called up. It means they're going to the next level. But maybe we'll start seeing a little change in Vermilion County. But right now, they need stability is what I'm looking for, and they don't got a lot of it right now. So that's about it. That's all I got to say. Somehow, I worked my way through this podcast again, and I sounded somewhat intelligent. I really appreciate you guys listening. One last final note that I almost forgot to talk about. We at Field Pass Hockey are doing an SPHL All-Star fan vote, and it will be dropping here shortly. It may even be dropped by the time this podcast stops. I should probably know this. I should probably give you guys rough dates before I lie about a bunch of stuff. So let me just pull that up. You guys got a couple of minutes. You've been listening this long. Why not listen for a couple more seconds while I look through my phone to find something that I should have already had teed up? So the fan vote is going to be from January 21st to 25th. That's what it is. So we're coming up on it next week. I don't know. What is today? 17th. So we're coming up on it anyway. So be looking for that on Field Pass Hockey. They'll be putting it out on the socials. I'll be sharing it out on the socials. All the other awesome writers and photographers that we got covering the SPHL here at Field Pass Hockey are going to be sharing it on their socials. So vote for your favorite players. Create your own all-star team. And let's have some fun with it. I'm pretty sure I'll have more answers for you. I'll be able to talk a little more about it and give you the major details. But to the best of my knowledge, you can vote once a day. And so you can vote for your guy as many times as you want throughout the week, I guess. That's not as many times as you want, but you can vote once a day. And that's the way I believe it was going, because we just finished up the ECHL All-Star fan vote. So be looking forward to that. That's going to be cool. And then make sure you're following me on Twitter right there. That's me, Twitter. Follow James at FPH Bulls. Follow me. I try to get out the latest breaking news that I can. And in minor league hockey, there's not a lot of breaking news because it's minor league hockey, but every once in a while I can sneak one out there that isn't on the SPHL transactions page, isn't on the ECHL transactions page. I'm not going to toot my own horn here, but I did break the Casey Kolzicki Colton Fletcher trade a couple weeks ago. So every once in a while I can do something. Most of the time I'm just spewing out stuff that you can look up yourself on the SPHL transaction page. But I do my best to try to keep you guys up to date, give this league some good coverage that it deserves, and So yeah, so give me a follow. If you're watching the video, I ask every week, leave me some comments, give me some feedback. Let me know. If you're not watching it on YouTube, hit me up on Twitter and tell me what you think of it. You know, respond to my tweet about the podcast. You know, respond, be like, hey, James, you suck. You really need to shut up. Just stop the podcast after your guest is off because it just goes downhill. Then at least I'll know. That's what I've been thinking all along, but nobody's told me. So how am I supposed to know? I mean, maybe you guys love this part. Maybe you don't want guests. Maybe I'll stop bringing guests on. No, that's stupid. I know you guys want guests. It's the only reason you listen. Anyways, that's it. That's it. That's all I got. That's everything from this week. Episode 14 is over, and I will catch up with you guys. Until next time.